Hello everyone, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Saroj Yadav, Assistant Professor in Department of Education, University of Allahabad. Today, we will discuss about the Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act 2009, role of authority and civil society in program implementation. The objectives of this module are to give the students an understanding about the major provisions of RTE Act 2009, to provide an understanding of the present scenario and challenges ahead, to understand the role of state, center and civil society in the implementation of RTE Act 2009, to provide an outlook of the SSA scheme. Dear students, as we know that many programs and strategies are conducted for the universalization of elementary education. RTE Act 2009 is the landmark in the history of Indian primary education, which provides free and compulsory education for children within the age group of 6 to 14 years. So, first, let's look into the RTE Act 2009. As all of us know that for the universalization of primary education, central and state governments are doing continuous efforts. The most important step in this regard was the Article 21A, which was introduced in the Indian Constitution through the 86th Amendment of the Constitution Act 2002. Its purpose was to make elementary education a fundamental right, and its constitutional legislations, the Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act 2009, which became operative on 1st April 2010. With this effort, India became one of the 135th countries to make education a fundamental right of every child. RTE Act 2009 ensures the enrollment, retention and completion of primary education of the children of age group 6 to 14 years. Now, let's understand the major provisions of RTE Act. As we have come to know that major educational provisions of RTE Act is free and compulsory education of the children of age group 6 to 14 years by state government. At any time of academic year, a child can join the school and demand for his rights. There should be special provisions for the dropouts. Private, unaided, non-minority educational institutions have to reserve 25% of their seats starting from class 1st for the weaker and disadvantaged students. Enrollment, retention and completion of primary education shall be ensured. There should be strict criteria for the qualification of teachers, and student-teacher ratio should be 1:30. Government and local bodies shall establish neighborhood schools. It means that primary schools up to class 5th shall be established within the walking distance of 1 kilometer of the neighborhood. For the children of class 6th to 8th, school shall be within a walking distance of 3 kilometer of the neighborhood. Private schools should ensure that deprived children shall not be discriminated with the other children of the class. Their class shall run with other students of same place and time. RTE Act also prohibits the unrecognized schools from practice and makes provisions for no donation or capitation fees and no interview of the children and parents for admission. No admitted child shall be held back, expelled or required to pass a board examination until the completion of primary education. Physical punishment and mental harassment shall be prohibited. Monitoring of the rights of children under this act shall be done by the National Commission for the Protection of Child's Right or the concerned state commission. The schools need to have certain minimum infrastructural resources such as classroom for every teacher in school building, one office, one multi-purpose hall for headmaster, storeroom, separate toilets for girls, arrangement of clean drinking water, kitchen for midday meal, playground, library, teaching learning materials and sports material, etc. Now let's see at the present scenario and challenges ahead. When we start any program, we may face many challenges for its proper implementation. There are also many challenges for the proper implementation of Right to Education Act. These challenges may arise due to many social, political and cultural reasons. RTE Act 2009 has got long way to go before it achieves the goals set forth under it. Most of the states have not achieved even half of the 100% target enrollment of students from the underprivileged section of the society till now. As we have come to know that according to the provisions of RTE Act, 25% of the total seats in any private, unaided, non-minority schools should be reserved for the weaker sections of the society. But most of the schools have not contributed even a single seat under the prescribed norms. According to the convener of RTE Forum, only 5% of the schools are following RTE guidelines. There are problems such as shortage of around 10 lakh teachers, untrained teachers, para teachers, and student teacher ratio, infrastructural deficiency for children with disabilities, etc. Perhaps some states have plans to increase the scholarship amount for disadvantaged and children with disabilities. Many states have taken initiatives in conducting community awareness programs to bring children to school. Being a developing country, India is facing different kind of problems. So, implementation of RTE Act is definitely very difficult. While this act is to be implemented all over the country, different kinds of challenges are arising with respect to different states. Some major challenges are financial challenges, lack of schools and other infrastructure, lack of qualified and good teachers, lack of quality in education, challenges to enforce 25% quota for deprived section, backwardness of our society, etc. Many states of our country have raised their voice about their inability to mobilize funds and create a dispute with the courts. It is a major challenge for the implementation of RTE Act. As we have come to know that there is provision of neighborhood school in RTE Act. According to it, schools up to 5th class is to be established within 1 kilometer of walking distance from the residence of the children, and schools from 6 to 8 class within 3 kilometer of walking distance from the residence of the students. Now it is very difficult for hilly and tribal areas. In Himachal Pradesh, Bihar, etc., many primary schools are not within the walking distance. 89% schools of rural areas do not have toilets. Our country needs 7 lakh schools to fulfill the aims of RTE Act, which needs substantial budget. It is one of the serious problems faced in implementing this act. There is shortage of almost 10 lakh teachers in India. Many schools have single teachers only. Most of the teachers are not devoted, so they are unable to do justice to their profession. According to RTE Act, no student should be dropped or failed till the age of 14. So, weak students will also be promoted to next standard. Thus, with the mix of such students in the class, suitable efforts would be required to maintain and impart quality education. It is the responsibility of the teachers to encourage harmony amongst the varying strata of students. According to RTE Act, there is provision of 25% quota in private, unaided, non-minority schools will be reserved for deprived section. But definition of deprived and weaker section is also a big challenge. Malpractices may occur in this situation. So, a monitoring mechanism should be set up to ensure the proper implementation of this clause. So, we know that more than 40% of Indian population is living below poverty line. In such families, generally, parents send their children to earn money as child labor. Approximately 12 million children are engaged as child laborers and are not getting education. So, it is a big challenge to bring back these children to school. There is lack of awareness about education among parents, especially in rural and tribal areas. There is negative thinking about girls' education also. So, backwardness of the society is also a major hindrance to achieve the aim of universalization of primary education. For the proper implementation of RTE Act, monitoring should be done by separate government agency. There should be a strict action against teachers for the violation of this act. Now, let's analyze the role of state authority in the implementation of RTE Act 2009. It is the responsibility of state government to ensure the availability of neighborhood schools and to provide infrastructural facilities like school building, teachers, staff, and teaching learning materials. It is also the responsibility of state government to ensure that no any child shall be deprived of education due to economic, social, cultural, language, local, gender, physical, or any other barriers. To ensure the admission, retention, and completion of primary education of every child is also the responsibility of state authority. State government will bear those responsibilities of free and compulsory education which are not defined as the responsibilities of central government in section 9. Proper monitoring of the implementation of RTE Act is the responsibility of State Commission for Protection of Child's Right, that is SCPCR, on state level. Now, let's learn about the role of central government in the implementation of RTE Act 2009. It is the responsibility of central government to provide grants for the implementation of this act and to prepare an effective framework for the national curriculum, to provide quality training for the enhancement of the primary education, and technical and research related resources and related help are also the role of central government. Monitoring of different schemes and programs and to take appropriate steps for any violation of this act is also the responsibility of central government. Proper monitoring of the implementation of RTE Act is the responsibility of National Commission for Protection of Child's Rights, that is NCPCR, at central level. Now, we shall discuss about the role of civil society in the implementation of RTE Act 2009. Central government can't fulfill the responsibilities of the implementation of RTE Act without the help of state government and local bodies. It is the duty of state government to develop schools very soon where it is not available. Recruitment of enough number of teachers and quality education should be ensured. By the way, enrollment of students in primary schools is increasing very fast, but the quality of government primary schools need to be enhanced. For this proper execution of this act and for getting successful results, role of authority and different civil society has been determined in this act. There have been many private schools and government-aided private schools operating for several decades. As we know that the involvement of private players and civil society is not new to the Indian education system. There are independent efforts by NGOs, corporate foundations and individuals aimed at achieving the objectives of providing good quality education. Private school enrollment continues to rise in almost all states, and their influence on children's learning outcome is substantial. As we know that the private sector and civil society not only help to overcome the financial constraints, but are also helpful to address the issues of quality. The private sector and civil society can be used for providing infrastructural facilities like school building, transport facilities, ICT, libraries, laboratories, etc. They can operate and manage public schools and can help in bringing innovations in education, improving pedagogy and teachers' training. NGOs and corporate houses play very important role in mobilizing the community and making education accessible to disadvantaged. Private and corporate sectors have different skill sets and can make important contribution in specific areas of education. You must know that according to RTE Act 2009, private schools have to reserve their 25% seats for the deprived and weaker section of society. It is the responsibility of private schools to provide the relevant information asked by government nominees. No school shall any kind of capitation fees during the admission. Schools will not expel any student from the school before the completion of the primary education. Disciplinary action may be taken on the violation of this provision. A school management committee will be organized in which members will be the representatives of local government, guardians and teachers. 3/4 members will be from guardians, proper representation will be from the deprived section and women. School management committee should monitor the functioning of schools. It is the responsibility of the school management committee to monitor the proper utilization of grants received by government. It is the responsibility of parents to provide primary education to their children and also encourage others for the same. Responsibilities of teachers include their regular presence in school at time, to complete their course, provide remedial teaching, to organize parent-teacher association, etc. With the passage of RTE Act, changes have been incorporated into Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, approaches, strategies and norms. The changes encompasses the vision and approach to elementary education, guided by the following principles. First is holistic view of education as interpreted in the National Curriculum Framework 2005 will implications for a systematic revamp of the entire content and process of education with significant implications for the curriculum, teacher education, educational planning and management. Next is equity, to mean not only equal opportunities but also creation of conditions in which the disadvantaged sections of the society, children of SC, ST, Muslim minority, landless agricultural workers and children with special needs, etc., can avail of the opportunity. Access not to be confined to ensuring that a school becomes accessible to all children within specified distance, but implies an understanding of the educational needs and predicaments of the traditionally excluded categories, the SC, ST and other sections of the most disadvantaged groups, the Muslim minority, girls in general and the children with special needs. Gender concern implying not only an effort to enable girls to keep pace with boys, but to view education in the perspective spelled out in the National Policy on Education 1986-92. That is a decisive intervention to bring about a basic change in the status of women. Next is centrality of teacher, to motivate them to innovate and create a culture in the classroom and beyond the classroom that might produce an inclusive environment for children, especially for girls from oppressed and marginalized background. Next is moral compulsion is imposed through the RTE Act on parents, teachers, educational administrators and other stakeholders, rather than shifting emphasis on punitive processes. Next is convergent and integrated system of educational management is prerequisite for implementation of RTE law. All states must move in the direction as speedily as feasible. Despite so many efforts, there has been some criticism about the Right to Education Act 2009. The act has been criticized on the following grounds. First is that it has been hastily drafted, not consulting many groups active in education. Second is not considering the quality of education. Next is infringing on the rights of private and religious minority schools to administer their system. Next is excluding children under 6 years of age. Many of the ideas are seen as continuing the policies of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan of the last decade and the World Bank funded district primary education program of the 90s, both of which, while having set up a number of schools in rural areas, have been criticized for being ineffective and corruption ridden. The quality of education provided by the government school system is not good. While it remains the largest provider of elementary education in the country, forming 80% of all recognized schools, it suffers from shortage of teachers and infrastructural gaps. Several habitations lack schools altogether. There are also frequent allegations of government schools being riddled with absenteeism and mismanagement, and of appointment made on political convenience. Despite the allure of free lunch in the government schools, many parents send their children to private schools. Average school teacher salaries in private school in some states are considered lower than those of government schools. As a result, the proponents of low-cost private school critic the government schools as being poor value for money. Furthermore, the system has been criticized as catering to the rural elites who are able to afford schools fees in country where a large number of families live in absolute poverty. The act has been criticized as discriminatory for not addressing these issues. In the words of well-known educationist Anil Sadgopal, it is a fraud on our children. It gives neither free education nor compulsory education. In fact, it only legitimizes the present multi-layered inferior quality school education system where discrimination shall continue to prevail. This was all about the RTE Act 2009. Hope you have now developed some understanding about this very important act. So now, dear students, let's have a brief review of this module. This module has described the Right to Education Act 2009 and its major provisions, present scenario and challenges ahead have been presented. Role of state, center and civil society in the implementation of RTE Act has been discussed. Major educational provisions of RTE Act is free and compulsory education of the children of age group 6 to 14 years by state government. At any time of academic year, a child can join the school and demand for his rights. There should be special provisions for the dropouts. Private, unaided, non-minority educational institutions have to reserve 25% of their seats starting from class 1st to weaker and disadvantaged students. Enrollment, retention and completion of primary education shall be ensured. According to RTE Act, no student would be dropped or failed until the age of 14 years. So, weak students will also be promoted to the next standard. Thus, with the mix of such students in this class, suitable efforts would be required to maintain and impart quality education. It is the responsibility of central government to provide grants for the implementation of this act and to prepare an effective framework for a national curriculum, to provide quality training for the enhancement of the primary education and technical and research related resources and related help are also the role of central government. It is the responsibility of school management committee to monitor the proper utilization of the grants received by government. It is the responsibility of parents to provide primary education to their children and also encourage others for the same. Thank you.